Welcome to the 160 monthly meeting of the New York Linux User Group. Tonight we're going to be hearing from Sam Boyer, who will be talking about his experiences migrating a large open source project from CBS to Git. The project is Drupal. Tonight, before we get started, three quick requests. First, if you could take the time to silence your cell phone, that would be greatly appreciated. Second, if we can avoid using those awesome coffee makers in the back during the presentation. They are incredibly loud, so please don't use them. And if you have any questions, we're going to try to give the mic out. If you can raise your hand, I'll run and get you a mic. But, you know, Sam's going to try to repeat the questions for the video, if not. At this time, I'd like to thank our sponsors at Google for graciously allowing us to use this great space. Also, we'd also like to thank our other sponsors, IBM, Canonical, Brander Group, and O'Reilly Media. Speaking of O'Reilly Media, at the end of this meeting, we'll be giving away three free ebook coupons. They will be rewarded by a show of hands for answering three trivia questions regarding today's talk. We'd also like to thank... We'd also like to thank our many NYLUG volunteers who have contributed greatly over the years. If you'd like to reach out to us, you can reach us at info@nylug.org. And feel free to check out our website, www.nylug.org, and our mailing list and IRC chat. After Sam gives his talk, we're going to be convening to a local pub called McKenna's at 250 West 14th Street. We'll be going there as one or two groups. And at this time, we open up the floor for announcements. Forrest, do you have an announcement?
I got a quick announcement. I just wanted to let everyone know that we have not confirmed a venue yet, but the 5th annual Software Freedom Day will be taking place here in New York City. Those of you that came to the first one 5 years ago and were treated to the surprise experience of our event showing up, hacking. So we're doing it again. We're hoping to do it at Pybeam, which is actually pretty close by. It's just down the street. We may end up doing an ITP and rating combination, and we're going to have some great talks, hopefully by XCTO, a well-known tech company. I can't say anything about that. We're going to have probably Wikimedia, a photo hunt that's going to go on all day for Software Freedom Day. Last year in Europe, they did the world's largest photo hunt. They're still, looks like they're going to begin to prepare for that. And then so this is going to be on September 15th, it's a Saturday. And so all day, anyone I think can participate. And there's going to be a number of historical sites to collect photographs for the Wikimedia Commons. And then in the evening, we're going to have our Software Freedom Day celebration, which generally involves a couple of really fun talks and a lot of people who are working free software getting together and having a great time. What was that date? Who remembers the actual day? Raise your hand. Who doesn't remember the actual day?
Okay.
If you don't remember it, you can't come. It is Saturday, September 15th. It's the first year we haven't done it on the last weekend of the summer. It's Saturday, September 15th.
Okay, as many of you know, we have a workshop, Hackfest, every 2 weeks. Rob and David are two of the organizers. When is your next meeting, guys?
This Tuesday.
Okay. Also, I think that's it. I'll just let you know that next month's topic is scientific computing with Python. So with that, I'll hand it over to Sam.
And it might even work. I can't tell if this these levels fine. They seem fine. Great. Okay. Hi, everybody. How many Drupal-ish folks do we have in here? Okay, and like, familiar with Git? Show of hands. Familiar with GitHub? Enthusiastic hand in the middle. Again, this is a log. How many like sysadmin types do we have? Sort of more than things. Cool, and more like developers, programmers, coders, and then regular users. Not to, you know, criticize you or anything like that. Not at all, we can do. Cool, all right, just wanted to get a sense of where y'all are at. This is my first time doing this talk, which is actually sort of saying something. We finished this migration coming up on 18 months ago now, and I have never actually spoken publicly about it, so this is going to be fun. I've spoken plenty of times wildly gesticulating after imbibing too much alcohol, but this is the first time that I've done it before imbibing too much alcohol, so this should be interesting. But it's going to be pretty informal. I'm happy to have folks jump in with questions as we go. I'm going to go into a fair bit of detail on both the sort of the technical side and the social side, because as I think will become clear, you really can't have a migration like this without considering both. It's both are equally important to the overall success of the project. So hopefully there'll be something sort of interesting for everybody. And also, just to note, the to-do thing to do tonight is to get schlitzed and then come watch the campaign at 12:01 a.m. because that's what we're doing, because it's going to be hilarious, because Will Ferrell's going to punch a baby in the face. And that's just my favorite. So, we're doing that at like the 34th Street AMC or something like that. Cool, show up if you want. All right. February 24th, 2011, after 8 grueling months, Drupal switched from CVS to Git. Whole software. The actual migration process itself took 14, 16 hours, something like that. We ripped out the entire undergirding infrastructure that was CVS, replaced it all with Git, migrated all of the live data into the new system in that time period, preserved all of our CVS history, and rolled it all out. And worked. Crazy enough. Good enough, in fact, that the system is only run with relatively minor tweaks for the last 18 months. That's actually a nice way of saying that after we finished the migration, I and other people on the team found it rather difficult to find the time to continue making improvements. But hey, it worked well enough that I haven't had to, because you know it hasn't broken down. But my role in this was as the lead engineer on the project. So I designed most of the infrastructure that runs right now. I'm the Git administrator for the project. So today I'm going to talk about the story of how and why. So the first thing to note is really that this is not a foregone conclusion. Yeah?
Only if I can. Was it only CVS that you guys were using? Because I remember lots of different types of source code management being in various nooks and crannies of Drupal before you actually migrated.
He asked if CVS was the only system that we were using. There was a fair bit of discussion about other systems because those were the systems that people were using to manage Drupal projects. But the Drupal project itself and any code that you contributed to it, that was all CVS. It's a very centralized system, and you'll get details on that as I go through. But yeah. This is one of those like long-running cyclical discussions. Oh, sorry, a key question to ask. Who would sort of identify themselves as being a at least moderately active participant in a software community? Cool, okay. So if that's the case, then you are familiar probably with that pattern where this thing that you kind of want to do as a community comes up every 6 months, 12 months, something like that, and people argue about it just like cats and dogs, and then after nothing happens. That's what happens. It's like, hey, it'd be great if we did this, and then we rehash all the same points, and all the people who've been there for the argument 6 times before get annoyed at everybody else, and off we go. Well, that was us with our discussions about getting off CVS. We come up on the dev list and in various different places, and the Drupal founds and everything, and I think the discussions about it started. They probably started in 2005 or 2006, before Git was really anything worth using, but at that point, we were talking about at least getting away from it for first subversion. So we had been having this discussion forever, but we didn't seem like we could really get off of it for a variety of reasons that we'll talk about. But even if we did switch off, it's not even like we knew which system we were going to switch to switch to, and that was, of course, probably the thing that made it difficult. But unless you don't have laptops out, but there's this amazing discussion, and I'm sure these notes will be posted somewhere so you can go look at this. But February 2010, one of our most prolific, person in the community, Webcheck, Andy Byron, was having an annoyed conversation in IRC with some other person working on Drupal Core about some annoyance in CVS. And she had a particularly large amount of coffee that morning or whatever, so she decided that she was going to start a discussion about moving off. And for whatever reason, the stars were aligned. It took off. She made this post, which is a wiki page on Drupal's group site, And it picked up about 400 comments in the space of a few days. Everybody who was anybody weighed in. We all got all of our opinions out, and it just turned into this avalanche where we actually went through all the stuff that we've been kind of pecking at for years, and we said, all right, we went from, gee, wouldn't it be nice to someday move off of CVS to, we're moving off of CVS, we're moving to Git, we're doing a one-to-one conversion, and we defined most of the scope for the entire migration in that thread, in this sort of space of 4 days. It's a really interesting thread to kind of read. I mean, at least it is for me, but there were so many different things brought up, so many different ideas and perspectives, and it's just, it's massive, and a lot of it pretty well thought out. But we had the discussion, and like that, you know, things were shifted. All of a sudden, we knew that we were switching. It was just a matter of time. We had to decide how exactly we were going to do it. But to understand the relevant considerations, I got to talk about a little bit of the background and just make sure that we're on the same page in terms of what Drupal.org actually does so that we understand what we're talking about when we're talking about migration. So first, Drupal.org is a code host, packager, and the canonical update server for all of Drupal.org, all wrapped in one. So it hosts the code, it generates all the packages, and it provides update information so that all Drupal sites can ping back and figure out if there are updates, particularly if there are security updates. So it is, without Drupal.org providing that service, the whole software platform would fall apart. It's also the canonical bug tracker and documentation source, for the most part of the documentation. We have our issue queues, and they're very, very important to the way the community functions. Our documentation, which, as deeply flawed as it is still what it is. and without it, we'd be in even more trouble. So, really, the central social environment that Drupal.org represents, a lot of people, myself included, believe that it's been instrumental to the kind of success that Drupal's had. This is actually one of the concerns that was brought up in the discussion in the context of, well, can we even move to a decentralized thing like Git? Do we relinquish too much control simply by virtue of the fact that the version control system is decentralized? And not really. You can use it in similarly controlled and canonical ways, as I'll talk about. This concern is really one that's at the forefront, and I'll just go a little bit more. But numbers as well. At the time of the migration, we had about 9,000 projects. These were not, there was one large CVS repository, so in CVS, these were just subdirectories inside of the repository, the way the CVS works. But with the migration, they were all transformed into individual, separated Git repositories. That number is now at about 19,500. And when we migrated, we had about 6,000 people who contributed. That means they'd actually been through our vetting process for giving them CVS access. And that number is also now at about 19,500. Actually, it's a little bit misleading, but that's fine. I'll stick with that. So, we ended up taking Git for a few reasons. First, we pretty much threw SVN out right from the start. Just the amount of effort that it was going to be, we said, a centralized system. Oh, sorry, yeah.
What is your definition of a project?
It is...
What was the question?
Yes, what our definition for a project is. On Drupal.org, that it represents a independent piece of Drupal code. In Drupal world, that means a module, a theme, or distribution profile. An independent piece of code that hooks into the Drupal system in a specific way that's intended to fulfill a specific role in the way that the Drupal software works. But it's a modular piece of code, essentially. The Drupal core itself is also a project, a special case project, in many ways, but yeah. Does that answer your question though? Cool. Yeah.
What size groups does it support?
He's asking what size groups, what supports. We don't have any situations like that. The general workflow for the way that things work is you get access to create projects. You create projects, you have, you know, you are the owner of the repository, you can add additional people as co-maintainers if you want to. And, you know, some of the larger projects that I've seen have maybe 20 or 30 people on that list, and the system scales to support that fine. That's not a scalability issue for us. That's much more of a social scalability issue than a technical scalability issue. How do you have 1,000 maintainers? So we basically threw SVN out because it just wasn't going to be enough different, and it was becoming clear, and this is early 2010, GitHub was starting to catch fire but hadn't really caught fire yet. And it was becoming pretty clear that, you know, the way to go in the future was decentralized. We also had high hopes for the possibility that switching to a decentralized model would help unlock some of the remarkable deadlock that we experienced in working on Drupal 4, which is takes a long time to get stuff into Drupal 4 and a lot of persistence. We were hoping that making it easier to at least integrate the patches and whatever else, and not having to chase head all the time when other commits happen and your patches no longer apply, would help. So we said, okay, we're pretty much just tossing SVN out right from the start. And then we went back and forth and back and forth on Bazaar versus Mercurial versus Git.
Yeah. So yeah, the Mercurial thing is kind of curious to me. Was that when you said? I guess my first question is, when did they say whether they were going to go to Git, and why that one, and then how would come later? But wasn't Mercurial a real contender in some ways because it's all distributed?
He asked, wasn't Mercurial essentially why was Mercurial a real contender because it's also distributed? Yes, I mean, and Bazaar is as well. In fact, the Python project ended up selecting Mercurial right around the same time, and they had a very interesting memo explaining their thought process on it. What's that?
It's a big surprise there.
Yeah. Well, between Bazaar and Mercurial structurally is a lot more similar to Git. Bazaar has some major foundational differences, particularly the fact that they don't multiplex branches; they actually represent them as directories, which is That and rebasing tend to be the two most intractable points over which Git and Bazaar people will come in close. As I nearly did a few times
versus
this project. But basically, we went back and forth, and you know, whether you're talking about performance or whatever else, honestly, it's a wash. It really is. Like, what mattered? Were the people. We had way more Git people than anything else. If you look at that issue that I had a link to earlier, it's a smorgasbord of information in there, which is, I think interesting to go through just the wiki page, not even the comments. And one of them, you know, there's actually a couple sections where people have like volunteered to, you know, work on one or another, and it's like Git, 30 people, Bazaar, 8 people, Mercurial, 2. So, you know, writing's kind of on the wall. But
those two people were really good.
Nice.
They were. Really, it was much more of a Bazaar versus Git fight, and I had a couple epic battle royales. Anybody know David Strauss? I had a couple epic battle royales with David Strauss over. He's an excellent guy. He's come around to the Git way of thinking. Ironically, all of the Drupal.org infrastructure is still in Bazaar.
Oh, it is?
Yes, it is.
That's my original question. Interesting.
Many of our infrastructure team people, David being one of them, a number of other folks, were Bazaar fans, and they, you know, made the choice to switch to it a couple of years earlier, with sort of anticipation that that would be where we'd go, and we just have not gotten around to shifting around.
So are they protecting their understanding?
No, they're not. There's none of that. People are fine with getting out of it, but David still complains occasionally, but it's fine. It's on. So really, like, the why Git question is kind of less interesting. I think, like I said, ultimately, these systems are in large part interchangeable. There's huge differences. You know, I mean, Git is in C and a bunch of like shell and Perl stuff that's sort of scrapped together. You got 140 commands and all the plumbing's exposed to command line. Whereas Bazaar is like 95% BCRLib, and it's you know, a Python API, and then there's this, you know, shell wrapper that operates around that. So very different philosophies on how the software itself is put together, but in terms of how people actually use it, like, it's kind of a wash, and it's kind of what you know. So we ended up going with Git. The more interesting question is, why not GitHub? And really, this question just gets more interesting with time, as GitHub just, you know, blasts through the ceiling of anything we could have ever expected in terms of social coding. To be clear, like, I do not regret our decision to stick with self-hosting at all. Still think it's the right decision and all. So first of all, our issue history and our documentation and everything would be unreconstructed. We have, you know, thousands upon thousands of open and ongoing issues which are on Drupal.org, and there'd be no way to move those across. You can't migrate that information, you can't migrate all the accounts, you can't do all the mapping. You know, as friendly and awesome as the GitHub guys are, and I've talked to them for a bit about all of this, but that's just, it's not feasible. So we essentially, in order to do that, we would have had to say, all right, you know what, fuck all that history that we had, we're just gonna start fresh. And don't get me wrong, like, we seriously talked about that, and I've thought about it a lot. There's some benefits to saying, hey, these six-year-old issues that have been like plaguing us forever, why don't we just kind of clean slate it and see what we can do. But it's kind of too damaging. The documentation as well. Again, flawed, but deadly to know. Another thing, though. There were open concerns, certainly, about using a proprietary platform to host our code and not actually controlling our code anymore. And while it's a decision that many open source projects are perfectly comfortable with, and I host other open source projects there, no problem with them, it is an issue. It's something you have to think about. And that also ends up relating to the fact that, so in order to gain Git push access, you have to click a checkbox that says, yes, I agree to this sort of set of things. And one of them is that as soon as I push any code to Drupal.org, it is GPL, period. And we can't enforce that on GitHub servers. Like, the fact that we self-host means that that can be a rule, and that can be part of the sort of community bond that is Drupal. But not possible to do if we're hosting externally. There was another thought there. What was it?
Did you ever ask the GitHub people to try and accept some of those terms? To try and support that effort? Not saying they should have, I'm just wondering if they were even cared to.
No, that's not a conversation that I had with them. I've been curious as to what their response is. I mean, I'm pretty sure I imagined what it is. It's just that there's no space in their whole concept model for the idea of, like, this repository being of a type. Like, it's a Drupal repository or something like that. And so these things apply. The best you can do is, like, have an organization, but that's not what GitHub organizations are designed to do.
Right.
Have 19,000 people in them?
No, it would change business as usual for them, for sure.
Yeah. The other type of thing is we have branch and tag naming conventions, which we use, which were enforced very strictly in the CVS days and are still enforced, but not so tightly now. You can name things whatever you want. You can only package into official releases if they conform to the naming conventions. But again, something that we wouldn't be able to do with GitHub. We also, when we package, we inject a license, we inject a GLD2 license out into the generated package, which, again, not possible with GitHub. So there were some sort of basic just technical requirements there. Additionally, we went back and forth with this for a long, long time. But we came to the conclusion that it would be too much of a barrier to many of our users to require key-based access, and this is before the smart HTTP was really coming around. Smart HTTP, if you don't know, as of Git 1.66, you can push over HTTP with Git. It can be encrypted, and it's in many ways it's the most sort of portable way to interact with Git. It has its drawbacks, but if you use GitHub and you've ever done that thing where you put the token in your gitconfig file, that's part of their use of smart HTTP.
You secure yourself that way instead of using SSH.
Yeah. And the big issue with us, of course, you can do key or password-based access with SSH. The problem is, typically, the way that you end up doing that is you, in order to do key or user-based access, you would have to have, you know, that number of Unix users sitting behind her, or some bizarre way of authenticating off to some separate user model overlay on your server, and that was not the direction that we wanted to go. We could not scale to having however the hell many Unix users.
So how do you do access control for repositories?
We wrote an SSHD in Twisted, which I'll talk a little more about later. But this was a big requirement for us, so we knew that we were going to have to. We wanted people to be able to, you know, use their username, sdboyer@git.org, and to have that work with either password or key-based auth and no millions of Unix users. But really, at the end of the day, like, I think it's the social structure question again. It could irrevocably damage the strength of Drupal's social structure that really holds the project together. Really? Irrevocably? Yeah, actually. And here's why. So, first, let me give a sense of really what makes Drupal more than just a bunch of people who hack on software and like put it in the same place, but there are actual like bonds that tie us,
distribution of labor.
There's ways in which we interact structurally inside of the community that make for a much richer interaction set and a more defined interaction set than you can have on GitHub. And for starters, there's the security team. Any project that is a full project on Drupal.org and has a real release, not an alpha, beta, or RC, but has a real full-on release, is subject to our security team. Somebody can make a security report about it, and our security team is responsible for going through and making sure that somebody gets that taken care of, issuing an essay, and doing all of that. So the simple fact that we give you permission to put projects on Drupal.org means that you have already become part of a social contract wherein you're responsible to our security team. This is one of those things that you consent to when you click that checkbox that says, I will work with the security team if I have to. You couldn't, this is just not a part of what GitHub does. They're a hosting platform, whatever else, but they're not a process manager. They don't impose any kind of community responsibilities like that. But being able to have that security team, that's a fundamental part of what Drupal as a project can offer to the world that wants to use it, is say, we have a sort of centralized way in which we manage these security issues, and you can guarantee that if there's a security problem, it's going to come through this team. Yeah? The service that handle all of this. He asked if this is physically in one location. Yes, literally it's hosted by the Oregon State University open source lab. So security team is one example of this. Another one is kicking issues across projects. So the way that issue queues on Drupal.org work. You can file an issue against any one project, and if the maintainer thinks that issue is actually better assigned to another project, then they can kick the issue directly across. They don't say close this and make a new issue or whatever else. You can just kick the issues around. Think about that for a minute. Can't do that on GitHub. Repository is a repository. Pull request is a pull request, and that's it. It's stuck on this one. But the fact that we can say, you know what, no, actually, I know that we're integrating code with you over here, but the balance of responsibility for this is actually on this module over here, and I can just send that issue that somebody made directly over to there. Like, that's some user coming in saying, hey, I need help with this, and instead of me being like, yeah, no, go rewrite everything that you just did and go over here, I can actually show them directly to where they need to go.
How is that mediated?
Yes, how's that mediated? What do you mean?
Just the person who receives the bug just arbitrarily moves it?
Actually, anybody can. Yeah, and it generally works fine. If anybody violates that, then it typically gets sent back to where it needs to be.
So we get kicked back, and there's also a record of where it was originally submitted.
Yes. Yeah. The way that it appears.
Yeah, but there's a trail. It's not like it's disappeared.
Yeah, it's the same issue. It retains all the same IDs and everything. It's just a status change. The project that it's assigned to is just another piece of metadata, the same way that it's a priority or whatever else is. So it's easy to move around. That puts us in a position where I am not in my own little isolated kingdom, even when I'm inside of my own issue queues. I can easily interact with the other people who are part of the community. Project canonicality is another really big one. GitHub, like Git itself, there's no such thing as a canonical repository, not inherently. The only thing that you really have with that in GitHub is there's one, which is the original fork, and then everybody else forks from that. You can look at the tree of forking. Really, there isn't necessarily one canonical project, and there's no way of identifying something as the canonical project. And that's a big issue for Drupal because we're not just out there, this isn't developers that we're necessarily just looking to primarily serve. We're interested in finding, hey, there's this cool library that I'm going to pull in for this thing that I'm working on. No, we actually have to be able to cater to relatively non-expert site builders who are trying to figure out how the hell to solve some problem with their Drupal site. And if we've got 10,000 forks or something and they have no idea which one of them is actually the proper one that they should be using, and that's not expressed in some kind of first class way that is backed by this whole community process, then they're going to have no idea what's going on. and believe me, people finding what they need on Drupal.org is already enough of a problem right now without just being like, yeah, you know, use whichever fork you want. It doesn't work. And last is pull requests themselves. So pull requests, amazing innovation. Like, and there's incredible stuff that you can do. But with the way that the GitHub's model works, one person by default has access to actually update code on the pull request. You know, I push a bunch of commits to this branch that I have. I issue a pull request to your repository, and the branch is still associated with my repository. They actually just released something that helps with this a bit in the last couple of weeks.
They, the Git folks?
The GitHub folks did.
Thank
you. And I'll explain in a sec. But so I, you know, have submitted this pull request to some other person's repository. I want you to pull this in. I want you to pull this code in. Anybody can go in and comment on that issue. They can go in and do awesome like inline code commenting or whatever else. But ultimately, I, the person who submitted the code, the pull request, am the only person who can make the changes to the code, because it's still in my repository and it's behind all of the access control that's attached to that repository. In Drupaldom, we have an awful, awful lot of situations where we've got multiple people collaborating on patches. And the idea of having our social model constrained so that the primary interaction is really like, you made the pull request, so you own this patch. And if there's a competing version, well, you're gonna have to actually open a separate issue. We can't have joint discussions, and we can't do that kind of thing. And you end up creating sort of a race at the bottom for whoever like opens the pull request first or whatever else. I think those would be the types of things that we would observe happening if Drupal had moved over to GitHub. And it would have hurt some of that model of openness. Now I have to say, like, I'm not saying that GitHub's model is wrong. Certainly there is a ton that you can do, and especially in like a lower mutual investment environment, it doesn't matter so much if it's just one person talking to another person about, you know, sharing some code back and forth. But we have developed social contracts in our community around multiple people need to be able to work on this. And if your repository and your pull request model doesn't support that, you can't really do it. So just recently they've, and I read this quickly, so I might not be 100% right, but just recently I think what they did is they set it up so that as long as a branch is attached to an active pull request, you can pretty easily set it up for like people who participated in the issue, whatever, to have push access to it. So it opens it up, which is similar to the model that we've been discussing implementing on Drupal.org and stuff. But yeah, so at the end of the day, like I said, it's really about this audience though. We already have plenty of focus on making Drupal.org a great experience for the people who developed it, but making it a good experience for people who actually use the software, that has to be part of our goal as well. It doesn't have to be in scope for GitHub, it does have to be in scope for us. It's part of where our success comes from. So, we can't afford to move to a situation which is gonna privilege devs more at the cost of users. We already do that way too much. All right, so, enough big general stuff. Any questions before I kind of move on to the details of this? Cool. All right. The other rough areas of work that actually went into our migration. First is the repository conversion itself. You gotta take all that data that's in CVS and you gotta move it over to GitHub. And then once you do that, it's really important actually to set up an official mirror. Yeah.
Did you actually find the SVN to get tools? Were you using SVN originally or?
CVS.
So did you find that there were tools for CVS to get automate that process, or was it,
yep.
And did they work as,
yep.
That, okay?
Yep, I'll talk about that, for sure. He's asking if we found tools that automated the process of moving from CVS to Git, and yes, I'll get to that in a minute. Once you've got your conversion in place, setting up an official mirror is crucial. It's in the category of making sure that, as I'll come back to repeatedly, much of your success is based on people's ability to mess around with it beforehand. Yeah.
I once commented that there was no real big black box that you point at an SVN or CVS repository and at the other end spews a Git conversion to someone.
No, there's no magical big black box. There's a lot of configuration and figuring out how you want it to work that actually goes into it. And like I said, I will get to that in a minute. But yeah, I have a whole slide dedicated to talking about the conversion process. But let me just break down these areas of work. So set up an official mirror, because that gives the opportunity for your community, whatever, to actually, you know, start poking at their stuff and get it's not for reals yet, but yeah.
How about intellectual problems? Everything considered open source or permission free?
Yes, as I said, as soon as you push code onto, as soon as you push code onto Drupal, it already has GPL. That is the license that attached to it. That is legally binding as much as all the people at the Software Freedom Law Center and the Electronic Frontier Foundation tell us. And you agree to that in order to push code to our servers. Once you have your mirror, then we actually had, to build a bridge between Drupal and Git, some way to get that data out of Git and available to Drupal so that you can use it and serve it and show it in Drupal context. Beyond that, then, you have to make your bridge between Git and Git and Drupal also work with that whole project management system that we have and our issue queues and everything like that, and the packaging and the update tools and all of that. And there's the documentation and training, actually getting our 6,500 whatever people that we had when we initially moved, and then just everybody else who didn't have an account but was still, you know, working on it, to figure out how to use Git. And of course, how to use it on Windows. That's one of the, I was going to mention that earlier, how to use it on Windows. Windows support has gotten better, a lot better.
Okay, nice.
But it was pretty rocky.
This is actually still unpleasant.
It is still unpleasant, it's true. It definitely is, there's no question about that. But this is one of the biggest points in favor of Bazaar in the arguments, actually. Documentation training, ensuring that, you know, the people who you're doing this for actually know how to do something with it after you're done. And then finally, as I mentioned before, our custom SSHD, which served our specific needs. I'm going to delve in on that real quick, because there's not too much to say there, but it's kind of cool. So we wrote this custom SSHD in Twisted, which is a great asynchronous
protocol.
What's that?
Python network protocols.
There you go, network protocols. Yeah, exactly. It has libraries for so many different kinds of network protocols, and it does async very well. It's what you would do simple async stuff before Node, you know, hit the scene and blew up everybody's brain.
And it already had SSHD support of some kind?
Yes, it already had SSHD support. Yes, there's a library called Conch, which implements, which uses the SSH and provides most SSH stuff with a very easy So what's actually kind of cool about this, we did a sort of one-off job to get it working on Drupal.org, but one of my summer code students from last year, he did excellently and then was looking for a topic for his bachelor's thesis, so he decided to try to take our daemon and turn it into something that was, you know, generalizable and potentially generally useful, which he's not finished, and we have yet to dig through, but we are. I'm getting to the process of trying to get it deployed on Drupal.org, but it's very cool and I'm pretty excited about it. It has interesting potential, but it's a pluggable Git daemon which serves multiple protocols. It can serve at the moment SSH and the HTTP protocol, which is really nice because it means that you can install one server that you can configure one time and connect to all of your background authentication services, and you know, if you have any mapping of incoming URL to where it is on disk, all that you configure at once instead of doing one crazy thing for doing Git over HTTP with Apache, and then a bunch of other crazy things for doing it with, like, Git Alight over SSH. One unified server. We're looking at potentially making it really easily proxy requests, so you can handle having, like, multiple Git servers that are behind a single abstract set of URLs, and even potentially serving up a JSON API for underlying Git stuff. If we do it well, who knows? Like, it could replace Git Alight because it doesn't, you know, require on hacks to the SSH authorized keys file. It just does its own native thing, and you can connect off to pluggable services for doing all of the things that you would possibly need to do to run a Git server. It'd be kind of cool. It's calling it Git XD, Git EXD. And the last area of work, probably the most important one, running it over and over and over again. It's an integration. You have to do it until your eyes bleed. You cannot stop running. Otherwise, it's absolutely fatal. I'll talk more about that later. But for all the people who are super excited about, you know, hearing about the conversion tool, I encourage you to look at this. This is not a quote from me. This is a quote from the PostgreSQL community, who also made a few attempts at Git conversions and had a lot less success than us, but this is one of their main talking points. Changing your infrastructure, workflow, and build tool dependencies is way harder than the repository conversion itself. The repository conversion is a pretty well-definable process. You understand what the inputs are, you understand more or less what the output should look like. It's the rest of the stuff that will make you tear your hair out, because that's where the requirements just go shifting around all over the place. That having been said,
Was a one-time conversion, like, was there the option of living in both spaces for a while at all considered? Or?
We considered it at the beginning, and then we realized we were batshit crazy out of our minds because it would have been so complex. It essentially would have required that we create a bidirectional sync mechanism between Git and CVS that ran all the time on our servers and ensured that they were always consistent with one another. And
always.
Yeah.
Did you consider having some projects be one way and some projects the other system, and each individual project is just one?
That actually, that would not have been beyond the realm of possibility because of, I'll get a little more into this later, but the library that we use to do that, the Drupal Git connection, is called version control API, with the intention that it's a general API which has backends for different types of version control systems, so it abstracts across the differences, and you could potentially have integration with multiple systems at the same time on the same Drupal site and do it pretty smoothly. Still though, the amount of complexity that would have added is enormous. It was an 8-month project, keeping it as simple as possible. And that would have made it extraordinarily more complicated. And in fact, actually, it's kind of an attractive thought, right? It seems like it would make it simpler because you can sort of have both worlds at the same time. People can go in their own time at their own pace and everything like that. And I certainly thought that way at the outset too. I think though that it's actually a bad idea. It's much better to be loud and public about the fact that you're doing this migration and really clear about like what the changeover requirements are going to be and beat the drums really, really loud when you're going to actually make that migration, because people will not pay attention and figure out what they need to do. And they do. Like, we made, you know, the actual night of the migration, which has some great stuff to get to, but the actual night of the migration, somebody made a because we had a Drupal Git Gremlin Twitter account that we, you know, put information out through, and somebody made a Drupal CDS troll account that night, and we tweeted back and forth when, you know, I wasn't actually working for most of the time, and just made jokes about the entire process the whole time. But like, having some fanfare around it, which you can't have if you have a sort of giant, smeary, sliding thing, having some fanfare around it helps people to realize, okay, this is happening, I need to get off my ass and figure out what I need to figure out so that I can continue maintaining my projects. And yeah, I think having both coexist at the same time is more technical complexity, and the loss of that social focal point means that it would actually not work as well. But, so, as much as I'm gonna say about the repository conversion, it is important to note that we actually had it relatively easy in terms of the complexity of our history. Because we have branch and tag restrictions, branch and tag naming restrictions, there was no like profusion of insane branches that, you know, were just named whatever this, that, and the other, and we didn't know what they were for, and we didn't know what to do with them. Fundamentally, if we had a wide open model for how people name different branches, and they just sort of did whatever they want, we would not have been able to do this. We would have to go through 9,000 projects and sort of say, well, what's this branch for? Well, what's this branch for? And or obviously we wouldn't have been able to do that. We'd have to apply some heuristics, but with this, because we knew that branches would be formed like Drupal-6-2, whatever, and tags were Drupal-6-2-3-alpha-14, shoot me in the face. We were able to make some assumptions, and it simplified the conversion process. Additionally, the history of the repositories themselves were not too insane. However, it's also important to note when moving from CVS to Git, CVS is more unlike Git than most other version control systems out there. CVS is, what was it originally off of, like 88 something, 90, I don't know, somewhere around there. So you know, it was a big step up from RCS, and that's great. But they have no concept of commit atomicity. When you commit in CVS, you perform a single network operation, but CVS records all of the file changes as separate atomic operations. And you can commit to like 17 different branches at the same time in CVS with one network operation. Because you can set the branch that any particular file is on to any different branch you want at any given time, and generally drive yourself insane. It's flexibility that, for the most part, isn't needed. The guy who's the author of the library that we use for the conversion of CVS to SVN, whose name is eluding me right now, has an interesting article on his blog explaining how there are certain valid use cases which really cannot be served by the tightly locked in atomic commit, directed acyclic graph driven system that Git and Bazaar and Mercurial are all based on. But by and large, for most things, it's much just simpler to say, I made a commit, it's got a bunch of file changes in it, this is an atomic thing. However, given these differences, it is almost impossible to like faithfully replicate CVS history. Because you have, you know, a change that was made over here, and you can try to figure out sort of how they all cluster together based on like looking at similar commit messages on different file changes, but it gets real tricky. And that was easier for us because we had because people weren't, you know, branching all over the place all the time, and since the branching tag namespace wasn't so complex, it wasn't that bad. Anyway, sorry, I'm kind of beating a dead horse there. CVS to SVN. It's a library which was originally designed to port from CVS to SVN, but the author wrote some additional bits in there so you could do CVS to Git or CVS to, I think HG is the method. I tried a bunch of different tools. I worked with the one that ships with Git, the Git CVS import. That's kind of nice. It has the advantage of being able to do incremental imports, so you run an import and then there are two more Git commits on 17,000 and it just does the two additional ones. It doesn't have to re-crank through everything. But it misses a lot of stuff, it screws up timestamps, if cache gets poisoned, which it seems to do to itself fairly frequently, like it can miss whole commits, it fairly regularly didn't actually produce at, you know, a branch endpoint the same code that was in, the same code in Git that was in CVS, so, you know, not so great. CVS to SVN, though, places the primary emphasis of that system is really, you know, some stuff's going to get messed up in the history because it's, for those reasons I was describing, CVS is a non-atomic system. It's really hard to reflect those things in an atomic system. You can't have like one-for-one commit parity. But it places a high emphasis on ensuring that all of the tags and all of the branches that are there, at the very least, when you run that migration, the branches and the tags are going to look exactly the same as they did in CVS. So even if all the steps you take to get there aren't exactly the same, your endpoints look right, which is ultimately the most important thing. It does mean that if you try to do some crazy merge out of your CVS imported history, sometimes stuff gets a little screwy. Some weird situations can erupt. But for me, for us at least, it was a wasn't that bad. So CVS to SVN comes with this giant config file where you can inject a bunch of information, including a giant hash map of usernames. So you have CVS usernames, and they map to a Git combination user and email, so that's the identifying information that's placed on a commit. So we built a giant, this is one of my favorite files that I ever named, cvs.csv. The guy who I gave this to, just like, he wanted to punch me in the face. Really, it had to do this to me. So we had a giant cvs.csv file that was used for the conversion, so that everybody was everybody had, you know, the username that they wanted. We also designed, this is one of the relatively few NIH complex things that we did with this, but we created a custom email format, an anonymized email format that allow people to, and they can still commit with this, you can commit using this format, which basically is it's your username, although it doesn't matter what's on the left side of the at, and then like your Drupal.org UID dot noreply.drupal.org. And if you commit using that email, when you push to Drupal.org, it will figure out that this commit belongs to you and it will associate it with your account and you'll get credit for it and everything like that. The big point there being that, well, everybody else in the Git world tends to be just like, whatever, I'll just have an email address in there and that's fine. That was, I thought it was fine. Other people in the community found a sticking point that we make all these email addresses public. So we created the anonymous format. We also hacked up GitWeb to prevent it from ever showing email addresses. Horrendous things, just GitWeb.
So you actually do use GitWeb?
Yes, if we actually do use GitWeb. Yes, we do. We're trying to get rid of it. GitWeb has issues, and it's really no longer maintained. But, yeah.
The Fedora infrastructure, we just got rid of it for this Christmas.
Yeah. What did you switch to?
Seagate.
Yeah, Seagate, I figured. Seagate's not an option.
Much faster.
It is. Seagate's not an option for us for a few reasons that I can't remember right now, but we have a couple of other things on the fire.
It will be an option pretty soon.
Seagate, for us? Separate discussion.
Nice. Forecasting.
Yeah. We had a script that went through and cleaned out all those great CVS keywords, the RID stuff that's expanded by CVS whenever you check out, but you just do the empty thing and it dynamically tells you when the commit with the file was last modified. I can't even tell you how long I spent arguing with a few people about this. Like, for a couple people, this was a sticking point on moving to Git. They were like, I don't want to lose my keywords because then what do I do when I call my clients who have tarballs and I don't know what individual words in the file is? And I had to actually have conversations about this. Like, if your client is too stupid to, if you can't trust that your client has downloaded the tarball, hasn't just modified everything and changed it, and is like calling you to, play an April Fool's joke. I don't know, whatever. Just go away. I can't give you a problem. We had some alternate approaches for that, but we didn't end up. Anyway, so we got rid of the CVS keywords, which has created a funny little phenomenon. In most Drupal files, you will notice at the top there's the open PHP tags, and then there's a blank line, which nobody else really does. But it's become standard because our script cleaned out the line but didn't remove the new line. So all of a sudden, all these Drupal files had this empty line at the top of the file, and nobody decided that was a good idea, just we forgot to pull the new line out. Weird side effects that really matter so much.
Are the keywords in there historically, or are they removed from history too?
They are. They're in there historically. There's an actual commit. There is a user on Drupal.org who, if you try to load his user page, it crashes because 9,000 repositories show up with like two or three commits in each of them. It's great. It did something else too. I can't remember offhand. I think it fixed some translation stuff or something like that. If you clone a lot of Git repositories from Drupal.org, you'll notice that the last commit on many branches that haven't been touched in quite some time is this cleaning up CVS keywords that happens in migration. The last thing that the repository conversion did is a separate step that we wrote, which was the verification of all branch and tag tips, ensuring that they are exactly the way that they were in the original. And that really did not tend to be much of a problem. Hurry this up, you know, and use the story parts. Okay, the Git to Drupal connection part. So this component is really where we have, how do we go from having Git data on disk in repositories into Drupal in a Drupal accessible way. So the SSHD is, the entry point. Someone was asking about this earlier. You come in, you make a request to the SSHD. It makes a simple HTTP request to basically a REST interface, which is exposed only internally, that has all of the ACL information about who can access the repository, particular branches, whatever else. It pulls that information back, and then passes things along to hook scripts, which are attached to all of the repositories. Hook scripts are really the starting point. If you've ever done any server-side work with Git, that's what you do. You stick stuff in hook scripts. Pull push, you trigger off events, send things to Jenkins, things like that. Our hook scripts do only a couple things. They really don't do much. They prevent, again, contracts, social contracts. If you have created a release, a package release from a branch or a tag, by going through the interface of Drupal and saying, hey, here, we have this, people should download this, we use this, then you cannot delete it from Git. It rejects any attempt to delete that branch from Git in order to ensure that we're not destabilizing public-facing work. Apart from that, though, we basically just stick a little job payload into beanstalk.d, and then there are a bunch of long-running Drush workers, Drupal workers, that grab them and process all the information in. We store a ton of data in our database directly, unlike GitHub. GitHub takes the approach where, on any given GitHub request, they do not a ton, but they are easily capable of firing requests directly back to repositories, reading information from disk, and then bringing it back up. They wrote a system, what's it called, BERT RPC, binary Erlang something or other, which is their RPC system for making these live requests. We never, ever hit the repositories from a webhead, ever. Yeah?
It may be using XML RPC.
It's not XML RPC.
I think they may, and I didn't say they are.
No, I know, and they don't. I'm saying they do not, because I know that they do not. There's a long post on it. They use this thing called BERT RPC. It's this custom RPC system, which uses one package stuff. They use the transmission format is BSON, so it's not XML. So GitHub, they basically store just the information that's in the branch tips and memcache, and they have, I think they've got, and I talked to them a year and a half ago, like they had, 700 gigs of memcache bins just constantly filled up with information. As soon as a push comes in, they flush everything out of the caches to just stick the latest tip information in for the most common requests, and then there's a while that GitHub can take a while to queue up some sort of less common things. If you're like navigating the tree from an arbitrary commit as opposed to like a branch tip, then it'll often take a little while to respond because it's going back and getting information directly from the repository. We store basically everything in the repository except the actual file contents. All of the commits, all of the changes to the files, and the deltas and everything like that, the number of lines change. We store all that information so that we don't hit the repositories ever from live or from our webheads. We just pull that information out of the database. Not the best choice necessarily, probably not the choice that I would make today, but it was a choice that was made. It's kind of a historical decision because, Git's pretty quick. CDS is pretty not. And the idea of doing live requests to CDS to get information off of a webhead and expecting it to be timely is hilarious. So this was mostly kind of a historical reality that was inherited from, there was a belief that there was no way that hitting disk would be possibly fast enough. You could put caching things in place, but as a result, we said, okay, that's fine, we'll go with this approach. We just suck all the data into the database, pull it out of there, and go. Nowadays, I'm really actively trying to get a system put in place where we can directly hit the repositories from the weapons, but it's interesting. Yeah, so.
Nice.
That's our big, scary, crappy diagram. I'll run into it quick. So, we provide read access over all three of the basic protocols, HTTP, Git, and SSH. The Git HTTP backend, which is a binary that ships with Git, is invoked by Apache, or just a VHOS that we have configured. The Git daemon, which ships with Git, is run over Xamarin.D, and then we have our twisted Git daemon, which I talked about before. And you can only push over the twisted daemon. When you actually push over the twisted daemon, it makes this internal REST request that I talked about before to we run an instance of varnish so that everything's cached and responsive real quick. Yeah.
Quick question. That big purple thing, I can't read it with a second.
Drupal's Git repositories?
Yeah. Drupal's Git repositories.
Plural.
This moment 19,500. Yeah, when we went from CVS, we broke all of the projects into their own atomic repository. They're all separated and everybody's got their own little sandbox to plan. Twisted Demon makes a request to Varnish, which hits back to this internal instance that runs, it's a Drupal instance that runs against the same database that runs production, caches it in Varnish, and that's basically just a JSON string with the ACL information that Twisted uses to decide, hey, do we give you access to push? Sets a bunch of environment variables, which then pass back to the repositories. Those git hooks read those environment variables to do the things like, that's how we know that you set a, that you've made a release on this branch, so you can't delete it, for example. So we pass that information, we inject it into the hook scripts using environment variables. It's really the only way to do it efficiently. And they enqueue their job in beanstalk D, as I said. That gets into the main pickup. By these workers, which are just sitting there selecting on socket for information to come in. And then they stick data into the database, which is then available offline. And the other part of this is we have all of our web heads, all of our web nodes. There are a couple of actions which you take on the website which actually do require write operations, not many. If you create a new project, if you promote one from a sandbox to a full project, if you delete one, then you have to move around the repository on disk. So those also enqueue a job in beanstalk D. It's picked up by a different type of worker, which takes care of it instantly. That is the basic breakdown. Questions about this? I'll tell, I guess, hopefully more fun stories, yeah.
Did you talk about what the Drupal.org copy running on localhost is?
Yeah, sorry, this is that internal instance. It runs against the live database, the same thing that all the web heads run against, but there's a specific set of URLs that is only accessible over that internal instance, which are the URLs that produce the JSON API information that's utilized by the Twisted Demon.
So is Varnish running on the same?
Yeah, Varnish runs on the same box.
Okay, so that's what you meant by local.
Yeah.
It's the same physical box.
Yeah, the Twisted Demon lives on the same physical box as Varnish, has the same physical box as this, just makes a request to itself, and only accepts the question from localhost. Yeah.
Yes, you've mentioned Drupal workers before, and I've seen you have Drush workers.
I do, yes.
At least two.
Yeah, Drush is the command line library for working with Drupal. We figured out a way, as far as I know, we're the first people to really do this, but we figured out a way to run Drupal eventively for a long time. You know, it's PHP, so ordinarily you have one request, spawns one process, sets up PHP, and then tears down at the end. These start up, wait on sockets, and take as many jobs as they can in a 15-minute period, kill themselves, get restarted. Yeah.
See, eventively?
Yes, eventively.
Just check.
In an evented manner. They respond to one PHP process responds to multiple requests. The reason that we have this internal only is, and we're changing this as soon as I get on it, Drupal 6 and previous passwords are hashed with MD5, and we have to send hash passwords out and to the SSHD for it to be able to compare, so we couldn't expose it publicly. Switching over to whatever we do with crazy salted SHA 256 or whatever we do with Drupal 7, we're switching over to that, at which point this thing could be public, it wouldn't matter. Okay, so this part where I just talk because I haven't been doing that thus far. So we had that whole big discussion back in February 2010. We're like, hey, this is great, let's do this. It sort of sat for like 3 months or so, and we realized that we really, really needed like somebody to do it and have it be the thing that they were doing. This wasn't just going to happen with some kind of effort. So Drupal Association decided to put some money towards it, and I was the natural person to do it for many different reasons. So we initially settled on some wild underestimate, and that got us through the first couple of months. That was like June 14th, 2010 was the first day that I actually started working on this. And that one was basically just me poking at stuff in my basement. I was really working on that version control library, the Drupal to Git bridge. There was a lot of work that needed to be done there. We basically rewrote the whole thing. It's a lot better now. I dislike some of the basic assumptions it has to make. Like I said, I would much rather hit Git directly than have to stash all the stuff in the database for something, but whatever. Pretty happy with the library. So I worked on that for a couple months, basically alone. We didn't make much progress. It was sort of hard to get traction behind it. There were plenty of people like whispering around, this is never going to happen. Much better. Maybe. So I worked on that for a while. We kept it smaller. And really the kind of moral of this part is, well, a project this big, it doesn't really matter if you stick one person on it. You need to figure out how to get community momentum around it. So we sort of spun our wheels for 3 or so months. We made progress. Some of the base work that I was doing in the library was good and useful and ended up, you know, making a lot of things easier later. But stuff didn't really take off until like early October. We brought in a new project manager who she and I became very close. I was going to be the maid of honor at her wedding, which ended up happening at DrupalCon just like a week after we finished up the migration. She came on, and we decided that instead of sort of just having small little scrum calls where I would kind of report what I was working on, and then I would individually talk with other people, that we should just open the scrums up to basically anybody who wanted to participate in the project. And it turned around like that. There was wild community enthusiasm about getting off of CDS, so you know that didn't hurt. But we opened up the calls, and you know those areas of work that I broke down before, basically found lieutenants for most of them. I had one guy who was working on the conversion process. I'd written a lot of the basic stuff. We had a mirror kind of in place, but he finished it out, and that was his component. I had another guy who was. He's the one who made the Justin suggestion in the first place, and he just kind of wrote it off the cuff, and it was the germ that grew into what we had. It was his area. I had one guy who was working with me on the version control library, and that was what he and I really focused on. And then I had a couple of people who were working on documentation. So the team grew to like 7 or 8 inside of about 2 weeks, and we went from making very slow progress to actually like grinding things out quite quickly. We shifted around too, and we started. We started having public demos we had a 2-week sprint schedule, and we started having public demos at the end of every week. And that made worlds of difference. We had a mix of people come on, and a lot of it was sort of familiar folks, but they actually came on, they actually looked at what we were doing, and it ended up generating this excitement back into the community. And that turned around because we got more and more people. By December, we had probably 15, 20-ish people working on various different parts of the project, and it really started picking up from there. I almost didn't sleep from like the halfway through December until we actually launched on February 24th. But at that point, my role became code integration and automation, and if I have only one lesson to come from this, it is our Drupal.org is one of those things that's grown organically over time, aka has no tests. All of the knowledge is lodged in the heads of the most highly paid people in a rather highly paid community, which means that, you know, it's not that they hoard it there, it's just that there's so many bodies all over the place that it makes it very difficult to make progress with this. And in order to get this whole system to work, we had to test it over and over again. From mid-December on, that's basically all I did all day. I didn't write much code after December. I just did integration. We had a bunch of Jenkins jobs that would run, and it would take 2 or 3 hours or so. And I would run through a manual set of tests with my project manager. And remember, I went to dinner one day. I wanted to kill everybody. I went to dinner one day. I came back, and I swear people were running around screaming, "The sky is falling! The sky is falling!" Because somebody had gone in, and they changed some setting, and they didn't know what the hell they were doing, and I wasn't there to fix it. And so like, I was gone for 2 hours, and we were a month and a half out from launch, and people were staunchly advocating that we push back by a month. That's how much crap had come off the rails, because we didn't have any kind of system for giving an automated reinforcement that says, yeah, stuff's actually okay.
know, we can rebuild, we can recover from this. And the lack of automated systems to give that kind of information, I mean, they are important and nice in building a good workflow in the context of a well-defined company or whatever, where people actually being paid, but my God, in an open source community where people are like volunteering, coordination costs kill you. They are the never-ending death. When you have so much information for people to absorb and it changes all the time and you don't share it well because you don't have clear sources of information or clear tools for giving you feedback about where your software is at, I must have turned away at least 40 people who wanted to help with it because they were like, how do I get this set up locally? I'm like, I don't know. I don't have it set up locally. I have a VM that I have carefully crafted over the last month and a half to getting to the point where it can actually function. We did everything on that VM. We did our builds on there. We let everybody test on there. We did our demos on there. We did everything. It was Git Dev, great, holy Git Dev. That was the thing that actually saved it. But I managed to work out this relationship with my project manager where we would run the builds, and then we would tell everybody to fuck off. and we would make sure that everything was okay. We wouldn't let anybody look at anything until we actually went through and said, okay, we know that there are these problems and whatever else, and then we would let people in. Without doing that, like, the wheels would come off. They absolutely would. Like, I did the one time that I went to dinner. It paid its benefits. We ended up pushing back release by a week, but that was it. And we ended up doing that mostly because our sysadmin had jury duty. But
blaming the government.
Absolutely. That's what I was doing.
Classic.
Totally.
Nice.
Totally. So, the best story, I guess. Migration night. So we scheduled migration for the 24th, and we were down in like, PM Pacific, and we were going to run for 12 hours or something like that, and then yay, it'd be up and it'd be good. We had things, you know, jacked up as much as we could. We ran 20 concurrent workers doing the repository conversion and all the parsing and everything like that. We had major problems with trying to run the parsing. Doing it sequentially would have taken like 7 days. Just with the, you know, hundreds of thousands of individual inserts and all the grinding that it had to do. Not 7 days, but 2 or 3 days at least. Which we kind of really worked out for that amount of time. So we, you know, compressed it as much as we could and we ran it day in and day out. So we knew roughly how long it would take. And the beginning went absolutely swimmingly. It was fantastic. Like, in fact, actually we discovered, I'm just gonna find this picture, we discovered that night that like 4 of the people who were there were not just scotch drinkers, but that we were all Islay drinkers. Who knows what I'm talking about? Please, there we go. All right, you understand it's the only scotch you drink, and yeah, because that's the good stuff. But like, I had my bottle sitting next to me and somebody else, you know, brought it up. It's incredibly kidding. We had a fantastic old time. While our data was remarkably consistent, it was not completely consistent, because what real data is never completely consistent. And there were a couple of factors, a couple of things that would pop up. We had a lot of verification checks to make sure that we didn't have any like extraneous branches or tags poking up anywhere or anything like that, that, you know, nothing that violated the standards was actually there. And of course, the hard and fast restrictions that we had in CDS for saying your branches and tags don't look like this had been put in a couple years previous, whatever, but hadn't been there forever. So there was some residual crack, probably 170 or so, you know, things that in the 100 times that I ran through this process, I just basically memorized. So there was that set of data. Then there was the set of data which there was some weird thing in the concurrent code that I had written which somehow dropped like one chunk of 3 repositories that at the very end of it. And the specific repositories that would be dropped were a product of the level of concurrency we were running at, since like you're running at 8, and you chunk 9,000 repositories into sets of over 8 and then into sets of 3, then you're going to get one set of 3. But if you're doing a 15 concurrency, the math works out differently. It's just going to be a different set of 3. I figured out that it was going to be that we were going to have this problem, and that wasn't a real issue. I could just manually resync them later, so I didn't really worry about it. On migration night, though, we went from running at like 8 concurrency to 20 concurrency because we had, you know, the infrastructure to take up, which meant that those repositories changed. We had this little like perfect storm happening. So we were drinking and having fun for the 4 or 5 hours.
till 8 or 9 o'clock when we actually got to the point where it was time to switch over to the verification. And two things happened. One is I didn't wait just quite long enough before clicking the button for the next to kick off the next Jenkins phase, and as a result, it hadn't quite finished with core. Which means that I got this giant spam coming back of every single one of the branches and tags is not in the core repository. So, you know, the single most repository, the one that has to work, looked like it was completely screwed. So, you know, that kind of threw me off balance a little bit. Like, all right, fine, whatever, it's just, I jumped the gun a little bit and fixed that. But then, I hadn't realized that this issue with the different set of repositories coming back due to the branch and tag stuff. So, or due to the number of, due to the concurrency level resulting in different repositories not getting parsed. Consequently, my log files were filled with repositories that I wasn't used to seeing having issues. And they're all stacked up against, of course, you know, the 170 or so that I've more or less memorized as supposed to be there, and then there's the ones that aren't supposed to be there, but they should be okay. And that would have all been fine. All of it would have all been fine. Most important lesson of all, your copy buffer is not endlessly sized. So, I'm sitting there, I'm watching Jenkins, and I've got all the stuff spitting out about, I've got, you know, branch tag failures, fine. I copy it all in, I drop it in a file on my local machine, and I grep it for some of the stuff that I know should be there. Some of the ones, like the broken branches and tags that must violate, and I know will violate, and they're not there. It's 11:30. I have data that I know that has to be there that's not there, and I don't know why, and I about lost my mind. It took me an hour to like even deal with the fact, and then about 2 hours for them to talk me down. And then we spent a wonderful, there was a 2-hour segment in there where we were arguing about whether or not we should roll the entire thing back, because hey, we don't know what's going on with the data. And what do you do in that situation except say, well, we'll try again next week, you know. Finally, something clued me in and I said, you know what, let me just try re-grepping this, except instead of copying it to my local machine, I'm gonna go to the server where Jenkins is and grep the file right on disk that it's actually running to. Lo and behold, it was actually all there. Unfortunately, we were all a little tipsy because, you know, it seemed like it was going so well. It was 3 o'clock in the morning at that point. And, you know, how do you really see straight? Whatever it was, we ended up deciding to, some pivotal moment, my system was like, look, are you gonna bring it back up or not? I'm like, you know, do it, go for it. Bring it back up, clean as a whistle. It was so harrowing. I couldn't even, like, I don't think I had a conversation with my system for even the next, like, 2 weeks or so. I was so freaked out about the entire experience. You know, 100 times at least that I've run this migration, this data had to be there, and then all of a sudden, nope, it's not there. Not there. Anyway, there's more grist to that story, but you can hear it if I get hammered later and tell you, that's personal office. Some lessons. If you're gonna ever do, you know, a giant migration for a massive open source community, I'm sure that's all in your future and you're all looking forward to it. PostgreSQL actually got a lot of the really big lessons, and they, you know, banged their head against this for a while longer than us. So I'm just gonna run through those real quick. One, start with a Git mirror. Have that Git mirror on there. People can use it, people can see what interacting with their code in Git is gonna look like. They can get a feel for it. It will not be fresh and new using Git commands on their stuff, you know, the day that you roll out. Designate a specific Git migration team. I agree. Like I said, our project would have failed if not for the fact that we built energy around this team. We built a fun environment. We did these demos. We gave a chance to people to own stuff and to really, you know, feel like they were making a big difference, and they were. And that was at least as important as any of the architectural decisions that we made. The one that I already copied in. Changing your infrastructure, workflow, and build tool dependencies is harder than a repository conversion. Our repository conversion was done in November. That was not the hard part. That was not at all the hard part. I was worried about it. Not at all the hard part. It was the rest of the stuff that got tricky. Make friends with the conversion tool authors. I didn't actually end up doing this. I did have some conversations with them, but you know, our situation wasn't as, like I said, we didn't have such complicated history that we really had to do it. Write lots of docs about the new tools and workflow. Yes. In February, I think that I probably spent 15 hours on conference calls talking about whether we should recommend Git AM or Git Git diff for generating patch files. We still use patch files for people that are longer term.
You use diff?
Yeah, diff is the official recommendation. AM has issues.
Oh, gotcha, okay.
AM has issues. If you can use AM to generate a single a patch containing a single commit, but don't use it in its multi-commit format.
I see.
Basically.
So that was the deal breaker.
Yeah, it messes up Threader, which is kind of a big thing. Threader is a grease monkey script that works on Drupal.org to make the process of using the issue queues hot and awesome.
Thank you.
Yeah. See, the more history you have in your current system, the more work conversion is going to be. Yeah, it's kind of obvious, but true. But very importantly, things which are broken in your current history are not going to fix themselves when you migrate. Yeah, it's true. The tools are not magic. They will probably get a little bit worse. Although I would actually almost say a little bit of the converse here. We found this an opportunity, and once we had all this momentum, I used it as an opportunity to like jack some stuff in that was totally unrelated that we wanted to have for a long time.
Yes. Git seems to be a verb, but it's not an acronym.
Yeah, the stupid content tracker. The stupid content tracker. Check the man page for Git. That is what it says right at the top. I believe Linus was.
Is that a stupid tracker or a stupid content?
I think it's free for your interpretation. I think Linus always quotes a few things on it. Certainly the British word Git was part of the reason that he chose it, because it was just, you know, whatever. And I think it's fun to say. There's plenty of fun with talking about bisecting people and whatever else that comes with the very, very, they're really forceful verbs, a lot of those Git commands.
I was associated with the Wild West.
Yeah, fine. What's that?
I never associated it with England. I always thought Wild West.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like, Annie, get your gun.
Oh, yeah, no, that's different. That's Get. Git is like a stupid person.
Oh, okay.
The British slang for a stupid person.
Well, I learned something stupid then.
There you go. Hence the stupid content track.
There is a Western word, Git.
Yeah,
the technical word.
Is there? As in giddy up?
And when you're riding on horses.
Yes. Yes, indeed. It does sound familiar. Right, sorry. They say when testing the conversion, make sure to look at more than just head and your branch tips. Like I said, it didn't matter that much for us. If you really need to be able to do complex merges out of your CVS history, you're going to have to care about that more. And there are some things you can do with CVS to SVN to make it a little bit smarter and to massage the way that it generates these branches that roughly correspond to your CVS history. But yeah, their biggest lesson is not to be in a hurry. I would also kind of disagree with that. But it depends on the environment that you're in. Like, as I said, I think for us it worked because we managed to keep all the plates spinning at the same time. It's great, but not for everybody else. So, that's what I want. Yeah. Build a demo environment, keep it current, and let your people poke at it. It's in the same vein as having a mirror. We had our Git dev environment. It was what it would look like. It was what Drupal.org would look like after the migration. People checked out our instructions that we had written, the docs that we had written. They worked with the various tools. They told us when things were wrong. They gave us ideas about how to improve things. Some feedback's annoying, but no feedback is way, way, way worse. Too much feedback's annoying, but yeah. And again, it gave people the chance to acclimate to the big change that was coming. It contributed largely to success. Like, we had set up a whole IRC channel for the deluge of confused people that we were expecting was going to be there like the day after the migration. We just sat in there and shot the shit the whole day. Like, there were a couple people who had questions and they came in, it was great, but it's just smooth.
So, did you write wrappers for Git to force it work for them?
No.
Or to help people with the version, I should say.
No. There was some discussion about that. Yeah, like client-side wrappers?
Yeah.
No. There's discussion about that for some particular cases, and I have tried on another occasion to write one, but no, that's not something that we did. Actually, I was going to put it in here. I have a proposal for using the Git Notes system for extending the way that we give credit, which would be easiest if we wrote some small Git wrappers, but no, we haven't actually written any Git specific. That was actually a big point. We wanted to not equip people with a set of Git skills that were going to be really specific to the way that Drupal uses Git. We wanted us to be as close to the way that the rest of the world uses Git as reasonably, you know, possible, while still respecting some of these community constraints. Initial migration, shoot for 1:1. Do not try to do too much of injecting a whole bunch of new features and at the same time as you're doing a massive system conversion. This is kind of obvious, but it bears repeating because, you know, it's a thing that happens. You have this giant project and you want to make it that much more sparkly and shiny. A big thing like this, few moving parts as possible.
Idealist.org just gave us that same lesson yesterday.
Yeah. It's good for pretty much everything. And then, like I said before, augment everything and run it until your eyes bleed. I would say that I could have done that migration in my sleep, and I might have actually been better off. If I had not been so jumpy on the gun that night, I probably would not have made that stupid mistake with grabbing the log. We would have finished 3 hours earlier, and you know, nobody would have gotten pissed off at anybody else. But automate everything. You need to have run that migration 100,000 times before you actually go for it on anything. That is the end of this thing. Other questions? Stuff want to talk about? Now I'm over on time. Yeah.
I'm just curious, like, number of files and size of the repository. Like, how big is it? I mean, I'm asking this because I'm curious how you compared the Git tips or the branch tips, you know.
We compared branch tips by...
Like, I'm just wondering how big of a scale that comparison was, you know.
Everything. We checked out from Git, we checked out from CVS, we ran a recursive diff, ignoring certain files and ignoring keywords.
How long did that take to run?
That process, well, that was one of the things that we parallelized. That component of the process, when we cranked it up to 20 concurrency or so, for the 9,000 repositories, took, where's the math? I don't remember the commit counts offhand of what we had when at migration time. But it was a lot. Questions? Yep.
This is kind of slightly off topic, but you mentioned that when people make commits, it has to be GPL v2. I hear
they
that...
They push. I can't control what you commit. I can only control what you push.
Okay.
It's GPL.
Yeah, you're right, of course.
And is it v2 or v2 or later?
It's v2 plus.
V2 plus.
I'm under the understanding that Drupal 8 will have a MIT licensed library in it. Is that going to be hosted on Drupal.org?
Yep.
Okay.
I refer you to our lawyer that we don't have. we had a legal liaison within the Drupal Association, and he's doing something else now. I don't know where our new legal liaison is. All I can say is I'm sure somebody's taking care of that question.
I have another licensing question.
Yep.
I've heard that GPL and PHP's license are not compatible. Is that ever a problem for you guys? Do you ever have a PHP extension hosted on Drupal.org?
There are a scant couple of PHP extensions hosted on Drupal.org. Not many. It'd be great if the community got into doing a little bit more of that for, you know, the appropriate cases. But often enough, actually, those things just end up being hosted elsewhere because they make more sense to host elsewhere. I don't know about the license and compatibility between PHP and GPL. I'm not really a license guy. I've argued with Stallman a couple of times, so that's about all. Yep.
So what would you have done differently?
I would have made a hard requirement that we ship with an RPC system so that we can directly access repositories from the web. That's the single biggest thing. Not being able to do that and having to jam stuff in the database and focus a little bit too much on that is it's getting trying. But on the social side, I am remarkably happy with it. We made some overestimates and some mistakes around the recommendations for the patching workflow. And that we could have seen better. Like, I think we just sort of, we overreached and we thought, hey, it's going to be all rainbow sparkly unicorns. As soon as we get this, it'll be fine. Everybody can follow the instructions. It'll work great. And we didn't test it enough. And the stuff that we put out there was a little bit too complicated initially. So we got a little bit too excited that we were listening to the people who were too close to us and not everybody. So we had to ratchet that back on. But, I mean, really, once we got going, like, I have rarely been so happy with the project that I worked on. So. Anything else? I guess that means it's time to go drink.
Thank you.